Welcome back. You're watching HFO-TV. HFO-TV is co-sponsored by J.R. Johnson, LLC, specialists in multifamily restoration and repair work, Gantry Incorporated, the nation's largest independent mortgage banking firm, Butler Exchange Group, offering 1031 tax-free exchange services, and Forensic Building Consultants, experts in the diagnosis, repair, and preservation of multifamily assets.
Welcome back to HFO-TV. I'm Greg Frick, partner at HFO Investment Real Estate. Today we have back with us Eric Fruits, Vice President of the Research, or Vice President of Research at the Cascade Policy Institute. In our first segment, we talked a little bit kind of about the history of homelessness and how it's kind of changed from, you know, kind of post-World War II and kind of where we are now today with, you know, we discussed kind of the addiction and mental health and affordability. Thought maybe, you know, we're in an election year. As we've talked about before, I think this homelessness and public safety are probably going to be probably the two biggest topics when we're looking at the city council election and even I think in the state for governor. So I'd like to kind of talk with you about, since you've done so much research, kind of what kind of solutions that you see are a possibility to address this, kind of maybe where, you know, the narrative is wrong and not adding up, and kind of get your insight on that now that we, you know, we're able to kind of get more of the background on how homelessness has changed over time and kind of where we are today.
Yeah, and if you think about it, a lot of what people talk about when they complain about homelessness is they say, oh, the tarps are ugly and right. There's garbage everywhere. But there's also these other components, too. We mentioned the substance use issues. You know, that leads to property crimes to fuel the habit. Right. There's an estimate that that a meth user spends anywhere between $24,000 to $93,000 a year on the drugs over the...
So how are they getting funds?
So how are they getting that? You see shoplifting in stores. The Fred Meyers near my house have armed guards. Yep. My wife went to go get a Blue Rhino propane tank for our little heater outside. And the guy at the store said, they're all gone. And she said, where'd they go? She said, they stole them. I said, all of them? She said, yes. They took a truck, hooked it up to the entire rack, pulled and it. Dragged the rack down the street. If you go through a homeless camp, yeah. You will see stacks of Blue Rhinos. And there is not a single one of those that were bought. And so going to policy prescriptions, you know, what we are doing now, we've had three major funding measures since about 2016.
Right.
We had the City of Portland Affordable Housing Bond, we had the Metro Regional Government Housing Bond, and then in 2020 we had Metro's what they call Supportive Housing Services measure, which is actually two new income taxes, one on businesses and one on individuals.
Right.
What these programs are focusing on is building what they call affordable housing with what's known as wraparound services.
Right. And so kind of like a home first kind of.
It's called a housing first
approach.
Housing
first, right.
The idea is that we don't care what state you're in, you know, whether you have mental illness, if you're still using drugs, we don't want to have any barriers to get you into shelter. The thinking is if we get you into shelter first, housing first.
Housing, shelter, not...
If we get you into housing first, right. Stable housing...
That'll address everything.
With wraparound services, yes. Then you will be in a place where you can start dealing with any issues you might have, you can find a job, and then you eventually can transition out. The problem with that, there's a few problems with that. One is this so-called affordable housing is very expensive to build. Across Portland and Metro's affordable housing bond programs, the average cost per unit is $320,000
right.
per unit. Metro is really proud that 320 units, an average of 320 units come online a year. You know, when you have unsheltered homeless in the thousands, you're looking at about 50 years at that rate
to
deal with the ones that we
right.
have.
Right. That's not talking about new ones coming in.
And that means you have to wait.
Right.
You know,
right.
And I don't see where the right. compassion is in saying, just hang on for a decade and then eventually we'll have a place for you. Plus, there's a lot of people who are not ready for housing.
Right.
They don't have the responsibility to deal with housing because part of that responsibility is a responsibility to your neighbors. So you can imagine someone who maybe is in recovery in supportive housing and maybe has a kid in supportive housing with them. And then you have someone who's addicted to meth who moves in who's not ready for that transition. You can see that there's going to be a lot of friction.
Yeah.
And so there's this idea, and I'm not original in this. Michael Schellenberger, who wrote the book San Francisco, has been pushing this. His idea, and I think it works, is he calls it shelter first, and then housing earned, and then the resources to bridge you from the shelter to the housing. The idea is that everyone should have a right to some sort of shelter that's outside. It doesn't have to be perfect. It doesn't even have to be nice. It just has to be better than outdoors. You know, have to have, you know, four walls and a roof and, you know, heat in the winter and some cooling in the summer.
But get that step first.
Get there first, and then that way you have an alternative to sleeping on the streets. And then as you demonstrate that you are ready for housing, then transition them into housing. And hopefully while they're doing that, the people who are currently in that housing are ready to transition into market rate housing, into, you know, re-enter. Because I think, you know, the policy goal is to help everyone become thriving, independent people. Right. I think the thriving is important, and I think the independence is important, because I think the independence gives you the self-esteem so you can thrive. And so, so you've got the shelter first, housing earned, resources to bridge that. And so that kind of gets in. I'm sure we'll talk about this with Mayor Wheeler and Sam Adams' idea for shelter.
Yeah.
The other prong of it too is, you may have heard of this measure that passed by an overwhelming majority called Measure 110, which decriminalized possession of large categories of drugs, including meth, heroin, cocaine.
The idea being, the supporters behind that were saying that, you know, get them out of the judicial system. You know, don't criminalize it, keeps them out of jail. But I, you know, was talking to somebody a couple of weeks ago, and we discussed that, you know, in theory, I can understand that. But as we talked about, a lot of people aren't ready to make a change. I mean, you have a lot of people that are addicts that are not walking in and saying, hey, I'm ready to become clean, put me in a program. And a lot of times there's some significant event, either a family member or it's the judicial system that says either you're getting clean or you're going to jail, and that's a way to get that, and that's kind of off the table now.
Right. And there, on Measure 110, there is a treatment component too that's optional. And from what we're seeing in the first year, which is still probably too early, to be fair, is that not many people are taking that advantage of that treatment option. And so part of me says, look, the Measure 110, in some ways, the ship has sailed because it passed by an overwhelming majority. Maybe voters will think they made a mistake, but I'm not confident in that. But in the meantime, we say, okay, fine. It's not criminal to possess, you know, a small amount of meth or heroin or any of those drugs, but it is still criminal to commit a crime.
Right.
And so if you are, I just got an alert from Portland State University because I teach there part-time, that someone attacked a student at PSU and stole their personal property. My guess is that wasn't an accident. They were probably trying to fuel some sort of habit. If that person was on drugs and they are arrested, then you should say, look, the drugs, let that go. Yeah. But the fact that you assaulted someone, that's a crime. We need to prosecute you for that crime. And prosecution can give you some choices. You can either go to rehab or you could go to jail, and that could be a very strong incentive for people.
Do you sense that thought process is coming? I mean, I'm sensing now, I was telling somebody this, you know, you look at the changes that have happened in here the last couple of years, and I think, you know, a couple of years ago there was this compassion's tolerance. I've got a sense now that citizens are just kind of to the point like, this isn't working. This needs to change. And maybe, you know, he's brought up about Ted Wheeler and Sam Adams' kind of proposal for 10. Yeah, maybe the politicians now are like, hey, we've got to do something different or we're going to be out. Because I wonder if that were even to come out today, would that pass overwhelmingly like it did, you know, 2 years ago?
Yeah, you hope it does. You know, the way I thought about it that really crystallized it for me is, imagine that something happen to these drugs, you know, the fentanyl or the meth, that someone poisoned them. And they poisoned them in such a way that if you took one hit, it'd kill you dead. If that was the case, we would have our public health experts all over it. We've got to get this stuff off the streets. We've got to make sure that to save these people's lives. Somewhere on that would be a crisis. But the fact that they're killing themselves slowly over the course of 5 years or 10 years, that's not a crisis. And to me, that's kind of wild. The other thing I wanted to mention, too, is that, you know, sure, the personal possession, fine, whatever. But the bottom line is these people are getting it from somewhere. And dealing is still illegal. Criminal. Right. It's a felony. Right. And in some cases, a federal offense. There are people dealing out of the tents and tarps. There are people dealing on the street corners. There are people dealing over the internet. It should be almost like fishing in a bucket to catch some of these dealers.
But there's no motivation to do that. I mean, there's no. Locally, there's no motive. It's almost like we'll just let it go, and what happens in the tent stays in the tent. And God, we hope they stay in there and don't go out and, you know, break things or steal things.
Well, and that's the libertarian in me. If what happens in the tent stays in the tent, that's fine by me. But the problem is it doesn't stay in the tent.
Exactly.
And that's the problem. Yeah. And, you know, I have a friend who has a business, you know, up on 33rd Marine, and he says that DEQ keeps coming in and hassling him because he says that there's, you know, some sort of, you know, environmental runoff from his facility.
And he's trying to tell him, go look out the street.
And he says, look, there's a motorhome over here where they are literally draining oil over the storm drain. It's like, that is where it's coming from.
Right.
And they say, oh, we can't do that. We can't touch that one.
So are you, you know, in terms of, you know, that kind of plan where you're looking at shelter and then working through services to get somebody, as opposed to this, you know, housing first program, which, again, I understand it, but like you said, it's going to take 20 years to even, I mean, we can't build it fast enough.
And I think, you know, it's easy to construct a straw man and say it's either or. I think maybe the right way to think about it is as a portfolio.
Right.
That there is a role for these expensive permanent supportive housing units. I think they'd be useful for the person, you know, the hypothetical single mom who's running from an abusive spouse or partner. That might be the right place for them. But I think where a lot of the resources need to be directed right now is to getting the unsheltered people into shelter. You know, the latest count says it's something like 4,000 or 5,000 unsheltered. That was from 2019. My guess is it's at least double that.
Right.
There's probably 10,000 unsheltered people in the region. We need to figure out a way to get them into shelter. And I'm sure you want to talk about the mayor's plan.
Well, so people that don't know, the mayor, there's a letter that came out from Sam Adams, who works for the mayor, about creating, you know, like 1,000-person campgrounds for the unsheltered. It mentioned about who, you know, would handle security, it'd be the National Guard and things like that. What are your kind of thoughts on that? Because that's been in the press a lot, this, you know, as we're filming this in here mid-February. Kind of what's... Again, I don't know if now they're kind of backing off, saying maybe it wasn't a proposal, it's more like an idea thought. But what's your kind of thought on that?
Well, I read the memo, all 8 pages, and it's a real quick read. I'm sure anyone can find it online, and it's worth reading. It's very clear that it's a lot of spitballing and brainstorming. Right. I know Sam Adams, and I know that he likes to brainstorm. And so I would not get too hung up on the details. You know, I saw National Guard, I thought, nah. That's probably not a good one. And I saw PSU graduate students, and I teach at PSU, and I thought, you know, A, some of them may not be ready for that, and B, you know, I don't think that's an appropriate, you know, an unpaid internship. That just rubbed me the wrong way. But I think there were some, I think, real key components to it. The focus on shelter, you know, again, getting on 1,000-person shelter, probably just not physically possible. I mean,
but the thought of it, talking about the shelter part of it, is where I think it gets lost in it. They need shelter. You got to get people. The idea that we're going to wait for affordable housing to get built, that you're going to put people in, I think, as you said, it's just not going to happen.
Well, back in when I first published my report on homelessness, it was in the middle of, or right around the middle of the COVID. The idea we came up with was, let's take the Portland Metro Expo Center.
Right.
the Expo Center and make that a giant emergency homeless shelter. The Expo Center is a very, very sad location. It's a sad building that has huge problems, capital problems. It's going to cost millions just to bring it back up to a place where it could be competitive in terms of the exposition market. And it's got a massive parking lot.
Yep.
It could fit, you know, probably 500 RVs. It could probably hold anywhere from 1,000 to 3,000 people inside.
Right.
It's got a huge kitchen. It's got a lot of facility. It could be, I thought it would be, and it's near transit.
Right.
And it's away from a lot of businesses and a lot of homes.
A lot of residential, yeah.
And so, I mean, in some ways, it's perfect. Someone in the city got the same idea at the same time, and Dan Ryan tried to pitch it. Metro didn't want anything to do with it because they think that there's so many valuable uses for the Expo Center. And if you read the paper today, Cirque du Soleil is coming. If you know anything about the Expo Center, Cirque du Soleil is the only event that brings the Expo Center into the black.
Right.
If you don't have Cirque du Soleil, they lose money.
Right, right. So it's not going to, yeah.
Yeah. But the other point of that, too, is, you know, I don't know if in Portland we have any facilities as big
for something
as
that.
The Expo Center. So if you're talking about having 3,000 person sites, that's a pretty big ask. But again, that's a detail. You say, okay, fine. We won't have 3,000 person sites. Maybe we have 500.
Maybe it's not the National Guard. Maybe it's not PS. But the idea being, let's really focus on how do we get shelter now for people on the street. It's not humane for them. And not always just focusing on this, you know, housing. Again, it's different components. I don't think one fits all, but it just seems like it's, you know, any kind of a bold idea comes out, it gets shot down right away based on the details. And you're like, okay, well, do you want to continue what we're doing? That doesn't seem to be working.
And it can work. Right. You know, it's funny, my right-wing friends, and believe it or not, I have a lot of them, you know, they used to love to make fun of Dignity Village. But you know what? Have you heard of Dignity Village in the past few years? You know why? Because it's not a problem.
Right.
It is a successful model for people who can't get into housing. And it's a model that can and has been tried to be duplicated, in some cases somewhat successfully. But that demonstrates to me that it is possible to do that. There's a way of doing it without a stigma.
Right. Well, hopefully politicians kind of listen to this. If people want to find out more about your research, they can go to the website below. And I want to thank you for taking the time to kind of enlightening us about the history and maybe just, as you said, I think maybe it's a mind shift of how people look at this issue and problem. It's such a big problem. I mean, there's been questions, you know, is it too big for an individual city to handle? Is it something, and I know part of that Sam Adams letter was about getting federal funds and things like that. Again, you know, you don't want to wait on that, but there's got to be a change in mindset in what we're doing, because what we're doing the last couple of years clearly is not working.
Yeah, and I think the way to look at it is, you know, just ask yourself, what if everything we thought we knew was wrong? And that's a journey I took myself. I've changed my mind on a lot of things since I started researching this more and more, and I hope other people do too.
Well, thank you for taking the time
to do that.
We'll see you again next on HFO-TV. Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
Our entire office specializes in multifamily real estate, making HFO the largest multifamily brokerage in the Pacific Northwest. Your success is our passion. Build your legacy with HFO. Call 503-241-5541 or visit our website at hfore.com for more information.